and right over his thorn-torn brow, the true prince of evil, the king of slaves. The obvious hatred expressed here is understandable when we consider that Satan's legal control over mankind was total and invulnerable to any human effort at breaking it, until Jesus. On the cross, his thorn-torn brow and pierced body provided the perfect blood sacrifice for our sins. Now, Satan's once invincible power is broken over anyone who believes on that blood. It's no wonder he hates it. Can we find this demonic doctrine in rock and roll? Sadly, yes.
Jesus died for somebody's sins, but not mine.
Jesus has become the focus of more ridicule in rock music than any other personality. Virtually every facet of his life and ministry is mocked and criticized.
Thick heart of stone, my sins my own, they belong to me.
This rock anthology is entitled The Birth of the Why and features the hideous litany of Satan we heard earlier. Here, history's most significant event, the incarnation of God, is questioned and trivialized. In like manner, Nina Hagen's Nun Sex Monk Rock lampoons the Madonna and Christ, along with songs about reincarnation, witchcraft, and blaspheming the Holy Spirit. She sings,
"And my little baby, I tell you, God is your father."
Jefferson Airplane's song, The Son of Jesus, is filled with sacrilege, suggesting, among other things, that Jesus was involved in the occult, had bastard children by Mary Magdalene, and that God the Father was sexually attracted to Jesus' daughter. This same blatant disrespect for the Messiah characterized the life and art of John Lennon. One biographer records that Lennon, early on in his career with the Beatles, drew a cartoon of a crucified Jesus. At the foot of the cross was a pair of bedroom slippers. During the Beatles' formative years in Germany, another biographer recounts how on Good Friday, the day that marks the Lord's crucifixion, Lennon made some nuns the target of his abuse. As they left their convent to attend worship services, they were shocked to behold across the street a grotesque life-size effigy of Jesus on the cross, which John had fashioned and hung from his balcony. As the sisters gazed in astonishment at this sacrilegious display, John started pelting them with Durex condoms filled with water. To top it off, he urinated on them while crying, "Raindrops from heaven." In his song, God, Lennon not only records his indifference to Christ.
I don't believe in Jesus.
But abases the Son of God by drawing a comparison between Jesus, JFK, Bob Dylan, Hindu mantras, and the Beatles.
I don't believe in Elvis.
These examples taken together make it obvious that Lennon's infamous quote about Christ meant a lot more than just a commentary on the unnatural adulation given to the Beatles.
Over comments John Lennon made, quote, "Christianity will go. It will vanish and shrink. We're more popular than Jesus," unquote.
He longed for the obliteration of Jesus as Messiah and Christianity as a faith.
That's reality.
The group Ludachrist pictorially and musically echoes Lennon's sentiments. This type of overt blasphemy is not unique. Virtually dozens of groups openly sing about wickedness that until recently could not be found outside of occult bookstores. For many, it's a matter of economics.
Ozzy Osbourne's No Rest for the Wicked, the new album, plus his new Wicked video.
Rebellion sells in rock, and for the hardest types, what can be more rebellious than to revile Christ and blaspheme God? Whether or not this makes them less satanic is a question we'll address later, but for now, consider the music of Merciful Fate, a group that takes their Satanism seriously. On the song, The Oath, King Diamond sings, "I deny Jesus Christ the Deceiver, and I abjure the Christian faith, holding in contempt all of its works. An icon for this confession of satanic faith could very well be this album cover by Celtic Frost, with the devil or some demon using Jesus as a slingshot, or the albums by Christian Death. This one is entitled Sex and Drugs in Jesus Christ. The bottom portion of this album, Blasphemy in the UK, is not shown because it features male genitalia. Though they belong to the man on whose chest the image of Jesus is projected, it's clear when you look at the whole album that the intent is to uncover the nakedness of Christ. Punk artist Lydia Lunch has performed with a number of bands in the last decade, among them Teenage Jesus and the Jerks. Her songs include Crown of Thorns and the strident I Am the Lord Jesus, most of which was recorded backwards. In the world of rock, even the most significant, loving, and sacrificial acts of the Lord's life, like the Last Supper, are dragged through the mud. In this, his last meal before his death, Jesus gave his disciples the bread and the wine to initiate a new covenant, a promise of love and forgiveness. The bread symbolized his broken body, and the wine his shed blood. Together, the horrible price he was to soon pay in order to redeem man. There was nothing funny about it. Graceland renames the Last Supper the First Snack and pictorially suggests that the menu included a prostitute. Here, MDC's album, Millions of Damned Christians, mocks, among other things, the blood of Jesus by connecting it with the key phrase from a well-known beer commercial.
I want to save this blood for you! It's all that you do!
This blasphemy is echoed by the album artwork for Blood on the Snow. The name for a group of witches, Coven has a demon playing his fiddle over the spilled blood of Christ. Likewise, The Cure's popular album, The Head on the Door, features, along with songs like The Baby Screams, the song, The Blood.
I have a life by the blood of Christ. Though it clouds my eyes, I can never stop, never stop.
Hebrews 9:22 states that, without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sin. The blood spoken of here is that of the Lamb of God. Apart from His blood, our sins remain as an eternal wedge separating us from God. To mock the blood is to deny our only escape route from hell. And that's why the desecration of the Lord's blood through ritual and liturgy is foundational to satanic religion. Other aspects of Christ's sacrifice are mocked as well. As we saw with Nina Hagen, and we'll see in great detail in our next section on the cross, a favorite occult technique for desecrating the sacred is to mix it with the profane. Take, for example, the crown of thorns that Jesus was made to wear. We've already seen Ozzy's. The Damned and Terence Trent D'Arby also mocked the crown, with D'Arby throwing in the crucifixion for good measure. This decidedly non-Christian group even calls itself Crown of Thorns. Moving on to Christ's sufferings on the cross, Spooky Tooth's album Ceremony depicts Jesus as some cosmic buffoon with his hand nailed into his head. The Sacred Heart of Jesus, the Catholic symbol for Christ's love and sacrifice on the cross, is mocked by the birthday party. To call the Lord's gift to us bad seed is as blasphemous as anything in the Satanic Bible. Along with the swastika in the background, the album features these cryptic lyrics from the song Wild World.
Our bodies melt together. We are war. Post-crucifixion, baby. Post-crucifixion and all I've done.
Coven also renounces the work accomplished through the crucifixion. Anton LaVey himself would have been proud to have penned the lyrics of Burn the Cross. Another Another way that Jesus is attacked is to lump him in with every other spiritual leader and religion known to man. This heresy, known as universalism, has become extremely popular of late, particularly with the growth of New Age religion. Pictorially, this concept is represented in this album by Creedence Clearwater Revival's Tom Fogerty. Note the light passing from Buddha through the crown of thorns, suggesting not only the unity of Buddhism and Christianity, but the higher position of Buddha and Krishna over the true Messiah. Likewise, the inside of this